our head. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
So Moses set out with his assistant, Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders he had said, "Wait here for us until we come to you again, for Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responding like a half verse. The Lord is king, let the people tremble.
He is enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth shake.
The Lord is great in Zion.
He is high above all peoples.
Let them confess his name, which is great and awesome.
He is the Holy One.
Almighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity.
You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and fall down before his footstool.
He is the Holy One.
Moses and Aaron among his priests and Samuel among those who call upon his name.
They call upon the Lord and he answered them.
He spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud.
They kept his testimonies and the decree that he gave them.
O Lord our God, you answered them indeed.
You were your God and gave them. You
A reading from the second letter of Peter. We did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have prophetic message. We have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my son, beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground, and they were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up, and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Lord Christ, be on my lips and in our hearts, that the word spoken and the word heard may be in truth your word. Amen.
Amen.
What if I told you that you could be transfigured? That your whole being and essence could be aflame with the glory of God? Maybe you'd call me a mystic. Maybe you'd check my temperature. Maybe you'd chalk it up to pregnancy hormones. I'm going to ask you to set aside any skepticism you might be feeling for the next 15 minutes. Don't worry, I'm not going to preach for that long, but just set aside the skepticism for 15 minutes if you have any. Today is Transfiguration Sunday. When we hear the gospel account from Matthew about Jesus' journey up the mountain and his glorification before three of his disciples. This account tells us something about Jesus, how he is in line with tradition, like Moses and Elijah, and the authority that he has from God. But this is not all that the passage tells us. I see here an invitation for our own transformation as well. This idea that we too can experience a transformative embodiment of God's glory is not just my wild idea. It rests within Christian tradition. One of my favorites is a saying from the Desert Fathers, Abba Joseph. Abba Lot goes to visit him, and he lists all the things that he is doing to follow Jesus. Fasting, prayer, meditation, and he asks Abba Joseph what he is missing. Does this sound familiar? It makes me think of the rich young ruler who approaches Jesus and tells how he is good at keeping the commandments and asks what else he could do. Be careful of this. If you ask Jesus what more you can do for him, surely he will tell you. And be prepared to be challenged. So the rich young ruler is challenged to distance himself from his wealth, to sell all he has, give it to the poor, and to follow Jesus. But back to our monks in the desert. They've already gotten rid of worldly attachment. And they've dedicated themselves to following Jesus completely. So what does Abba Joseph tell Abba Lot? He stands up and raises his hands in the air, and his fingers become as 10 pillars of fire. And he tells him, if you want, you can become all flame. I will confess to you, I don't know what this means. But I love it. And I love it because it challenges me in the way I usually think of spirituality and what it means to be a good person and a Christian. I usually think along the lines of Abba Lot and the rich young ruler. Okay, you follow the law, you pray, you meditate, you fast, check, check, check. Then I've done the right thing, and that makes me a good person, right? That means God will love me, right? So, with this erroneous way of thinking, if I'm lacking anything, it's because I haven't sacrificed enough. That I haven't done enough. Kind of along the lines of interpretations of what Jesus tells the rich young ruler. But that's not what we have here. Here we have a very different sort of invitation. We have an invitation to a mystical experience. An invitation to complete and total transformation. An invitation, I dare say, to embracing the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is not my strong suit. As a Baptist turned Episcopalian, I don't have a whole lot of experience with the charismatic movement of the church. Wherever you look for the Spirit, you will find change and dynamism and movement. The Spirit hovered over the face of the waters before creation. The winds blew back the floodwaters in the times of Noah. Winds made a path through the Red Sea in the time of Moses. The Spirit descended on Jesus in the form of a dove. The Spirit fell on the heads of the apostles as tongues of fire at Pentecost. And the Spirit appeared as rushing winds, opening and closing doors in the early church. And here's Abba Joseph, inviting Abba Lot to consider another way of being, of opening oneself up to the presence and working of God's Spirit, the possibility of becoming all. The more I think about this type of openness to God and the display of God's glory, the more I think of the word love. When I open myself to God, when I sit in spiritual direction and present a dilemma to my director, she invites me to sit before God. And what always happens is I experience God's love. No matter whether I'm in the wrong, which is usually the case, or I've been wrong, I experience God's Spirit moving, easing my burden, and showing me love. If I had time, I would tell you all about the Eastern Orthodox, who also have this concept I'm talking to you about today. They call it theosis, or deification. It's part of their concept of salvation, which begins now in this life and continues into eternity until we are united with God. But for now, I'll just leave you with that tantalizing tip. And now I want to turn to our epistle for today, 2 Peter, and this verse. Be attentive to this, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. That is what Peter writes. This theophany, this transfiguration of Jesus, the glory of God is like a lamp shining for us in a dark place. Think back to Exodus and Moses seeing God's glory on the mountain. They didn't know it, I suppose, but Moses and the people of Israel were about to embark on a 40-year-long journey in the wilderness. What sustained them on that journey? Manna and quail. I think also the memory of this divine encounter. It was to them a lamp shining in a dark place. So also for us, this story of Jesus' transfiguration could be a lamp for us when we face darkness. Or perhaps we can find comfort in the saying of Abba Joseph that we can become all flame. Or maybe there's a theophanous experience that you resonate with, that you can carry as that lamp. But we aren't to live solely by the light of the lamp, but only until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. There is a promise here. A lamp, a theophany, the shining mountaintop moment, it something that can get us through the dark time, but we cling to it until something greater comes, until we are transformed as well, until the lamp is not the only light, but the dawn arrives and light is everywhere, until the morning star rises in your hearts. Yes, you too will be transfigured. You too will be a vessel of divine light. You will experience the glory of God so close that it will feel like the piercing light of the morning star is emanating from within your own body. This is a remarkable promise. I wonder what it would take for us to be open to that sort of transformation. How might we cultivate in our lives the fruit of radical love? I think it starts with being able to accept God's love for us. With being able to sit at Jesus' feet and gaze at his glorious appearance. With listening to the voice of the Father, interrupting whatever brilliant ideas we might have, just like he did with Peter, James, and John. And hearing that voice direct us again to Jesus. As we sit poised between Epiphany and Ash Wednesday, let us take a moment to sit in the loving, brilliant presence of Jesus. I'm going to invite you to join me for 3 minutes of silence, which I will keep track of with my phone. Don't worry, there will be a timer at the end, where we can simply sit in God's presence and contemplate Jesus and God's love for us. I invite you to sit in a position that feels comfortable for you. It's comfortable you can get in those pews. Both feet flat on the floor if possible. Stay upright yet relaxed. Feel free to close your eyes or simply lower your gaze. Whatever you feel comfortable with. And the 3 minutes begins.
Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, especially Sarah, Yvette, and Devon, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants and allies by faith, may with joy behold your Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. And a prayer written for us by the Black Lives Matter Committee. Father, bless us as we strive to find our way to true racial justice in all its forms. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we sin against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we do not repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may die in your will and walk in your ways, through the glory of your name.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of God's peace with us. Changes like this in the coming weeks. Please take note of the announcements. Lent begins this Wednesday, Ash Wednesday, and we'll have a service here at noon. Father Mike will be presiding, and at Great St. Paul's at, I believe, 7 p.m. Yes. Also, we have not done a Shrove Tuesday pancake dinner here in a while, but they are doing one at Great St. Paul's this Tuesday evening, between 5:30 and 7 p.m. Please do stop by for that, if you're so inclined. The prayer that I read from the Black Lives Matter Committee was in response to the murder of Tyree Nichols, and you can read more about that in your book. We also want to announce that this afternoon there will be an Absalom Jones service at the cathedral at 3 p.m. Our own Deacon Vasu will be part of the service. You can come to see her and our banner and honor Absalom Jones at Trinity Cathedral in Trent. 3 p.m. Are there any announcements from the congregation? Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us